welcome. We're glad that you guys are here to worship with us. And I'm just going to go ahead and pray, and then we'll get into worship. Jesus, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for the opportunity to come and worship you. Lord, would we not come with these motives or agendas of you coming and fixing our lives or whatever else? Lord, but would we just come with hearts that want to lift up your name, with hearts that want to praise you, with hearts that want to thank you because of who you are, because of all that you've done for us, Jesus? You're worthy of our praise, Lord, so we pray that we would just give it to you this morning. We give your Holy Spirit free reign in this place, and we pray that none of us would leave unchanged. Thank you, Jesus, in your name, amen.
There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. Oh, I've tasted and I've seen. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord, Holy Spirit, oh Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. And I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord, Holy Spirit, oh Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord.
Jesus. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, God. We live for you. Holy, oh holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart. When the music fades and all is stripped away, and I simply call, longing just to bring something that's of worth that will bless your heart. I'll bring things appear. You're looking into my heart. so we fall down. We lay our crowns at the feet of Jesus. The greatness of His mercy and love at the feet. Yes, Lord, we fall down and we lay our crowns at the feet of Jesus. Oh, the greatness of His mercy and love at the feet of Jesus. And we Jesus, we thank You that we can come to this place, that we can come to Your feet, that we can sit at Your feet, Lord. We've come for You. We've come just to worship You, Lord, not for any agendas, not for any motives apart from You. So, Lord, we just cast all of our things aside, and we lock our eyes on You this morning, Lord. Would You turn our hearts to You as Pastor Jon comes up? Would You help him to speak every word that You desire he speaks, Lord, that it pierce our hearts and that we would all walk away changed. That it wouldn't just stay here on Sunday morning, but that You would give us faith, that You would give us grace to do the work that You have for us all week. In Your name, amen.
Good morning and welcome. Glad you're here to worship with us. For those of us who were here last week, if you're a guest here this morning, if you just happened to miss last week, if you want a little roll of pennies as a reminder, we talked last week about serving one another and how we're supposed to give our lives away one penny at a time, one piece at a time, right? Laying our lives down in love for one another. And so this is just meant to be a reminder. I've been encouraged this week by a couple different people who have put it on their dashboard or wherever, and they've seen it, and it's led to conversations. It's led to them taking actions. So thank You, Lord, for that actually, you know, maybe doing what it was supposed to do. But if you are in need of one, would like one, please come and see me. I do have some extras I'm in my office, then we can go ahead and get that taken care of. It's just meant to be a reminder that many of us aren't going to be called to lay our lives down all in one fell swoop, but we are called to lay our lives down little pieces at a time. And so that's just what that's all about. A couple quick reminders about announcements this week. There's a board meeting following service today. So if you're interested in the finances of the church, all are welcome to attend. It'll be in the conference room to the right as you go out. And it usually starts about 20 minutes after service. So if you're interested in that, by all means, feel free to attend. This Thursday night, there's a worship night, July 13th, starting at 6 p.m. So there's an opportunity to come and to gather and to worship and to just be quiet for a little bit. I'm going to tell you, it can be quiet because there's not a ton of people who attend. But it's kind of nice because you get to just sit and just get to be and get to sit before the Lord. And so there's an opportunity there. And then the youth group will be leaving next Sunday, headed to Kentucky. And they'll go ahead and be on mission for a week and then coming back the following Sunday. Please keep them in prayer leading up to and through. Please be in prayer for Phil and Amanda and Scott as they kind of put final preparations together as the leaders of this group, right, getting everything organized and coordinated and ready to go. And hopefully they can figure out how to pack everything they need to bring in their lovely 15-passenger van that was donated, because it sounds like they have a ton of stuff to pack. And so hopefully they're able to work their magic and get it all squeezed in there. But they definitely can be using prayer leading up to and through their missions trip. And that's kind of it for the announcements this morning. I'm hoping to get us out of here by noon, maybe, if we're lucky. Last week was a little bit later. But I think it's necessary, right? We're going to continue in our series this morning on true community. And we've talked about loving and serving one another. We've talked about encouraging one another. And the importance of all of those things. Those are just a few of the one another's that we've looked at so far. If you were to go through scripture, you'd find about, depending on who you listen to, 59 different one another's throughout scripture. Those ways that we're supposed to interact as the body of Christ. The way that we're supposed to engage with each other, and how through that engagement with one another in the body of Christ, it's a testimony to those outside the body of Christ when they see it, that there's something different about the body of Christ and the way that we interact and the way we care for one another, and there should be, right? We have the Holy Spirit indwelling us, filling us with the love of Christ, and that love of Christ is supposed to flow out of us to one another and to others outside of the church. It's not supposed to stay here, but it's supposed to go out from here, and it's supposed to be that place of practice. And so just a quick question. Anybody here struggling to love and serve one another the past couple weeks? Maybe not en masse, right? Maybe there's some areas you're doing really well of loving people and serving them, right? And I would expect that. But at the same time, I would expect that maybe there's, you know, one or two people that you're like, ugh, I'm struggling to love them, right? They've said things, they've done things, it's just something in me, I don't really want to sacrifice for them, whatever it might be. Right? So I would expect that. I think it's kind of natural. Right? None of us is perfectly loving yet at this point. And so, you know, there's this work in process taking place. And so us being able to be honest with that is hugely important. Right? And I believe that's part of the reason why we gather on Sunday mornings each week. And I believe this is really the reason why we come together. And I pray that as I talked last week in the introduction, that I hope that maybe a few more of you are maybe putting it into practice this week, is that this morning and throughout this week, you were asking the Lord, God, who is it that you would have me love today? Right, when I go to church this morning, God, I want to know, right, is there somebody that I can serve? Is there somebody that I can encourage? Is there somebody that I can come alongside and demonstrate your love to? And then give me the courage and the boldness to do just that. Right, it's one thing to ask the Lord to give me somebody to love, but then it's another thing to actually ask the Lord to go, give me the strength to do it. Give me the courage to do it. So when you walk in and maybe you're sitting there going, they didn't show up today. Hopefully that's not the case, right? Hopefully they did show up. Because the Lord had a plan and an appointment and an opportunity for them to receive maybe what it is that they needed. So there's a reason why, you know, we gather week in and week out. And these gatherings aren't just for catching up on worldly things. Right? That's a good thing. It's a positive thing to catch up on worldly things. But that's not really at the core of why we're here. Right? The reason why we gather is to talk about spiritual things, to help one another to grow into Christ-likeness. Put away the things of the world and to put on the things of Christ, right? That we need that constant reminder and that constant help. And so we need to be asking ourselves on a consistent basis, right? Who is it that you'd have me love today? And so the one another that we'll look at today requires us to be thinking about one another through the week. How many of you thought about a brother or sister this week? You don't have to raise your hand, you can raise your hand, whichever, but are you thinking about your brothers and sisters in Christ through the week? Or is the only time you think about them as you walk into church Sunday morning and go, oh, I saw you, I'm thinking about you now, right? But the one another we're going to talk about this morning requires us to be thinking about each other throughout the week, and not just thinking about each other, but really kind of pondering and considering and going deeper into that. And it's really kind of the opposite of where we started 3 weeks ago. If you have your Bibles, go ahead and flip to Hebrews chapter 3. If you remember, the first one another that we launched into in the True Community series was talking about encouraging one another. We talked about the love-hate relationship, encouraging the good things of Christ and fighting against and discouraging and admonishing those things that are sinful and that we're supposed to walk away from. And we go, well, why do we do that? Hebrews chapter 3. That's just bringing us back to where we've been already in this series. Hebrews chapter 3, verse 13. We're called to do this. But exhort one another every day as long as it is called today, that none of you may be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. Right? And so we're supposed to encourage one another daily to flee from the sinful patterns, the sinful behavior, the sinful tendencies of the world, right? So that we no longer fall victim to those things. We're to remind one another that we've been set free from it already. That we're no longer slaves to sin, right? We've been cast and we've been set free. The debt's been paid so we can go forth. And we need to remind each other that way. We need to encourage one another because sometimes in our flesh, sometimes in the busyness of life, Satan in the world gets a hold of us. And he starts to convince us that, you know, this is really all that there is. And the deceitfulness of sin starts to creep in. And so we need brothers and sisters when we gather on Sunday mornings, when we gather for Bible studies, men's group like we did yesterday morning at 8:30, right, to come together and to encourage one another and to remind one another that that's not true. But that's not who we are, right, that we're supposed to flee from those things. And today's message is about kind of the flip side, a little bit more so about encouraging the positive, right? And so we need to kind of think through that. You're already in Hebrews, slide to chapter 10, right? This is where we're going to launch for today. We're going to land on two verses, really only one, is really where we're going to sit for all the rest of the morning. Hebrews chapter 10, and as you're flipping there, we're going to be looking at verses 24 and 25. And the writer of Hebrews comes in, and he's talking about how we have this assurance of faith, and how we're supposed to have confidence to enter the holy place. Right? Because of what Christ Jesus has done for us, we have a confidence to enter in and to be reminded of all that's been done and the cleansing that we've received through Christ. We're supposed to hold fast to that hope, verse 23, right? Without wavering, because he who promises is faithful. We come to verse 24, and let us consider how to stir one another up to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. Right, we're supposed to not neglect the meeting together. But we're supposed to gather on a consistent, regular basis as the body of Christ, as followers of Jesus. Right, we're supposed to have this intentionality in our lives that through the weeks we're supposed to meet with one another. The crazy part about all this, and maybe we'll get into this verse a little bit more detail, in a future message. But the concerning part to me, right? And some of it's in our body, I think, and I think some of us need to be paying attention to brothers and sisters in this realm, right, to be able to encourage one another about this, right? Meeting together purposely for church and spiritual growth has plummeted in our day. It really has. Right? Regular church attendance, even probably 25 years ago, meant you were at church every week. Right? It was regular. You were there, pretty much 52 weeks a year. Granted, you took weeks of vacation and whatnot, but you were there the majority of the time. And unfortunately today, statistics and surveys and, Christian, Barner Research Group and Pew Research and those types of things has shifted and has come to realize that in today's day and age, in today's church, regular church attendance is considered once a month. 12 times a year is considered regular church attendance. And that's kind of scary when you think about it. And any of us who were in a relationship of any sort, if we only showed up to that gathering or we only showed up at home once a month, would we think we're healthy? Probably not. And so I just want to, that isn't the heart of our message this morning, but I think this is some of why we wonder why the church struggles with loving and serving one another. Because we're not necessarily engaged with one another enough to go, am I really invested in you to pour out my life for you? Do I really want to sacrifice for somebody I don't know? Now, we're called to do that, mind you. But it's not like we're called to only sacrifice our lives for those we know. We're called to sacrifice across the board, but it becomes a whole lot easier to lay our lives down when we know each other, does it not? My guess is if I ask husbands and wives here this morning who know each other the best, right, they're the most intimate with, either one would say, you know, I'll gladly sacrifice for them. Parents for kids, same thing, right? Relationship is intimate. Easily done, I'll sacrifice for them. Close friends, I'll sacrifice for them. But as that circle starts to go out, our likelihood to be able to go, yeah, I'm in, I'm sacrificing for them, goes down, does it not? So I just want to encourage you, right, kind of use it as a shot over the bow to examine yourself, right? What is my commitment to getting together with brothers and sisters on a consistent basis? Or have I slipped into, as the writer of Hebrews said, right, of not meeting together as is the habit of some? Maybe we've slipped into that. And if that's you, I want to encourage you, right? I'm glad that you're here this morning, and I encourage you to keep coming, right? And I want to continue to gather. I want you to continue to be encouraged to gather, right? But don't neglect meeting. It's crucial. And not just Sundays, but other times throughout the week, right? Meeting one-on-one, meeting with small groups, whatever that might look like. But that's just, again, shot over the bow. So let's shift ourselves back to verse 24. That's really where I want us to focus for the rest of this morning. Verse 24, let us consider how to stir one another up to love and good works. You might be sitting here this morning going, well, why do I need this? Why do I need to consider spurring brothers and sisters on? But I asked the question, and it was intentional at the beginning of today's message, right? Who's been struggling to love and serve one another? And there are some of you who raised your hands that, you know, yeah, I've been struggling to serve at least one person or maybe multiple people. I've been struggling to do that. That's why we need this verse. That's why the writer of Hebrews puts this in, you know, puts this text in, right? The Holy Spirit goes, this is needed in the body of Christ because loving and serving people isn't always easy. Anybody experience that? Oh, it's just always easy. It's such a joy to serve people. Right? It's so easy to lay my life down and to love them. Right? Loving everybody is easy. It comes natural to me, and maybe for some of you it does, more so than others. Right? But when you start to get into relationships, when we truly start to know one another, right, loving people becomes difficult. Loving people becomes sacrificial, inconvenient. And all of a sudden somebody needs something, and it's 1 o'clock in the morning, like, I don't want to do that. It's inconvenient. Right, so that loving and service isn't always there, and it's times that it gets worn out. And so I'm going to encourage you, I'm going to caution you that as we start to develop true community, but as we truly start to bind our lives together and live life out together, right, it could get difficult. Right, because relationships are hard. And there'll be times when you'll find yourself growing weary of loving some people. That's okay. All right, just don't stay there. Right? It's okay to acknowledge it's hard. But I'm not okay staying there. And that's where we need this verse to come along and go, who needs a kick in the pants, if you will, to get moving again? That's my own version of spur one another. Right? Sometimes we need a good kick in the pants to go, go. What are you waiting for? Well, it's really tiring. I'm really weary. I get it. How can I build you up so you can go again? That's what we're called to as the body of Christ. Right, flip with me, keep your finger here in Hebrews 10, but go back to the book of Galatians. So go backwards, back to the front of the Bible, Galatians chapter 6. We're going to see a very similar verse that Paul gives to the church in Galatia about this very thing, about how maybe you get weary in loving people, and he's encouraging them, he says, don't give up. Galatians chapter 6. And then when you get there, slide down to verse 9. Let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap if we do not give up. If we do not give up. Sometimes we're tempted to give up, right? Maybe that's where you're at this morning. You've got a loved one, you've got a family member, you've got a friend, whatever it is, whatever the relationship, whatever the situation, right? Sometimes it looks like giving up is the best thing to do. I've tried. I've been walking with this person for years. And they just don't change. Nothing changes. I get the same response. Paul would tell you, right? I'm telling you, right? Don't give up. Well, yeah, Pastor, that's so easy for you. Don't give up. Whatever. right? I'll admit there's times I want to give up. There's times in relationships that I'm like, there's times in the ministry I've been, I just give up. Who cares? Right? And yet then I'll have people, brothers and sisters, that'll come along through that week when I'm in that low spot at times. Right? There'll be people who will walk in and give encouragement. And like, you know, this was, you know, what you've done in my life has really touched me, or the message worked, or this, that, or the other thing. Is like, there's encouragement to continue going on. Don't give up. Right? And so when we get to that spot where we want to give up on somebody, remind yourself that you'll reap a harvest if you'll just persevere. That if you'll continue on when it's tough, right, eventually it will come through. You'll receive a breakthrough. I don't know how fast that's going to be. It might take a really, really, really long time. Right? But that we have the promise there that we will reap a harvest if we don't give up. So if you haven't already faced these situations, the time is coming. Right? My guess is if you haven't found that it's hard to love people, you haven't been in a very deep relationship. Right? Because when the ugly starts to come out, right, that might take a few weeks, a few months, a few years of getting to know somebody, but the ugly eventually might come out, right? Their garbage might come out at some point, because we're really good at keeping up a facade for a while. But when we walk with each other long enough, when we truly start to be honest with one another, that stuff comes out, and now we struggle. And so that's what today's message is all about. It's encouraging us when the things get hard to continue to go on. And so really this verse, 10:24, so if you're not there, go back there real quick. Because what I want us to see is there's actually two commands in that verse. So often we look at it as it's only one command, right? To spur one another on. And that's the primary of the command. Right? There's the thrust of what the writer of Hebrews is getting at. But how do we do that effectively? How do we actually get to the spot where we effectively spur or encourage or stimulate or stir up, right? Whatever other verses, you know, depending on your transition. How do you do that effectively? Right? And that's where the importance of the first verse comes in, or the first command comes in. Right? And so often, if we neglect the first command, we're ineffective at the second. It's just, it's not necessarily clear there, right? So if you're there, verse 24, let us consider. There's the first command. Let us consider. I said earlier, right, when I opened this thing, that we're supposed to be thinking about each other throughout the week, regularly. Right, and it's true, right? The writer of Hebrews is telling you to consider one another. Right? Maybe if you have the New Living Translation, it says, let us think of ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good works. Right, notice this does not mean, this idea of think about or consider does not mean think and consider about whether or not you're willing to do it. Right, that's not what the writer of Hebrews is saying. Stop and consider, do I really want to spur or do I not? The spurring is not optional. The spurring one another is a flat-out command. This is what we're supposed to do. There isn't an option. Well, do I not? No, you do. The question is how? And you do that by considering them. Thinking about, and here's what that word means, think or consider. It means to put one's mind onto something, to observe or consider carefully and attentively. It means to study and examine. How many of you are studying and examining the people sitting next to you? Husbands, wives, yeah, we probably do that pretty well. Right? Other people are like, oh, do I have? Yeah, you have to spend time studying them, examining their lives. Many of you sit next to the same people week in and week out. You just do. Right? And I'm glad you do, because it makes it easy for me to be able to go, oh, they're here this week or they're not here this week. It's a good thing, but at the same time, it's a fun thing when you stir things up too, because then you get to meet new people, right? And now you get to realize there's other people in the church that maybe you've seen in passing, but now you have an opportunity to talk with. Right? Or they get to talk with you, and you've built these other relationships. It's not just all sticking together, but we're supposed to think about them carefully and attentively. We're supposed to study and examine their lives. And so this is going to take time and concentration on our behalf, right? Right. That's what we're supposed to do. And this is, we're supposed to set aside time and consider that. And so this idea, right, is taking intentionality on our part. That means when we come across this word in Scripture, and there's other places that it is, considers in the Bible all over the place, right? One of the easiest ones is in James, right? At the beginning of James, when it says, consider it pure joy when you face trials of many kinds. Think about, ponder, study, why is it a joy when I'm facing trials? Study that. Dig into it. Investigate. There's nothing good about trials. I don't want to study those things. There's benefits in it. Consider it pure joy. Right? And so we need to dig into those things. And so I want to encourage you guys to dig into each other's lives. And you say, what does this look like? Right? So if we are struggling to love and to serve, some of us are, thus we need to be spurred on. We need to be stirred up. We need to be promoted. We need to be engaged with doing these things. How do we do that? What do we do? What does it mean to consider? And so there's some questions that I'm just going to throw out to you. I think so when you start to consider one another, these are some things that we can ask ourselves. What motivates him or her? Ask yourself the question. What motivates them? Right? Maybe you've seen it. Maybe you've been around them long enough. You started to know what kind of works for them, what doesn't work for them. Right? Make a mental note of that. Another question, what are their strengths or what are their weaknesses? Right? Maybe God is motivating them to, you know, God is, you know, leading them to go and speak to somebody, but that's definitely not their strength. It's actually maybe one of their weaknesses is publicly giving testimony or sharing or somebody with somebody, and it's like, okay, so that's a weakness for them. That maybe changes the way that I need to spur. Maybe I need to come across it from a different angle if that's a weakness versus a strength. Right, so it's important we understand that about our brothers and sisters. What's their strengths and weaknesses? What's the best way to motivate them? Some people just need to put blunt. Right? Stop giving me excuses. Get out there and go do it. Some people need that straightforward approach from people. Others need a little bit more tender approach, a little bit more soft approach, coming in going, you know, I really think it'd be really good if you did this, and, you know, it'd be such a loving thing to do, and right, so we start to coax them in, and we start to soften them into that need. That's okay. Just in a different way that's needed to motivate. Not everybody responds the same way. You give somebody a point-blank, blunt statement, some of them are going to get offended and go, you're a jerk. Some will go, you got it, I'm in. I'm out, see ya, I'm going to do that. Because that's how we respond. And what motivates them? Another question, what discourages them? You know? You're starting to understand why it takes us the time to study and to ponder and to consider? Because do we know these types of questions about each other? What discourages your brothers and sisters you sit next to? And on the flip side, what encourages them? Right? We need to know those types of things. We need to study about those. Who would be the best person to talk to them? Right? I've come to find out I'm not the best person to talk to everybody. Because I have a tendency in my own flesh, in my own way of encouraging and spurring one another on, to be very blunt and maybe cold at times. Right? And so I've had that been told back to me, and so maybe at times I'm not the best person to come along and talk to somebody. Right? Because if I tell them, that if I go spur them, they're going to probably leave with a gash, and they're not going to like it. So I have to think about, is there somebody better to go and do that spurring? That I can bring into the mix and ask them, and that's why it's a plural thing. Let us consider. Not just you, not just me, but let us as the body of Christ consider what that looks like. A couple others, right? Why are they not inspired? Why are they not inspired? Right? Why are they not inspired to go do it already? What's happened? Maybe they've been rejected multiple times by the same person. And yet God keeps wanting them to go and speak, and like, I just want to give up. So we need to know that. They've been rejected all the time. Right? Or they've been abandoned, or whatever it is. Right? They've had some negative trauma in their life, and we need to know why they're not inspired to go do these things. It's helpful to be able to come alongside of that. And so that phrase, let us think of ways, right, is really about developing a strategy to motivate another believer, right, to experience victory in their life. To step into what God has called them to. And yet, when I sat and I study this for myself, right, there's some people I walk with that I think about that for. But do I think about that kind of en masse of how do I encourage, engage and spur all of you on? No. I don't think that that's possible. But at the same time, I think we need to broaden that some and start to consider how we can spur you on to love and good deeds. And you might say, well, why do I don't need to be called to that? How many of us are sometimes become lazy or complacent in our Christian faith? Some of us are willing to be honest on that path, because we do. Right? We get complacent. We get lazy. We're like, oh, somebody else will do that. Maybe. Maybe not. And maybe there isn't anybody else. Maybe that's you. Maybe that's me. And so we become lazy and complacent. When we become lazy and complacent, when we lay out on the couch spiritually and go, you know, I'm just going to put my feet up and relax and not do anything, when you know you're supposed to, we need a brother or sister sometimes to come up and grab us by the hand and pull us off the couch and go, no, no, let's go. And we're not laying down right now. There's some work that needs to be done. And as we look last week when we went through service, every one of us has works to do, do we not? Ephesians 2:10. Right? 2:8 and 9, we're saved by faith, right? By grace, through not by works, all that stuff, right? None of us can boast. It's a beautiful thing. But then verse 10, right? We're God's workmanship, prepared to do good works, right? That he prepared in advance. And so every one of us here, if we put our faith and trust in Jesus Christ, has good works that we're called to do. Right? Each and every one of us. And if we're not operating in those things, then be prepared that somebody should come alongside and spur you. Shouldn't be a surprise. Might be painful, yes, but it shouldn't be a surprise, because if we're going to be a healthy church, that's part of what a healthy church looks like. We're stirring one another, and we're moving one another down that path. And so there's some things that we need to think about down that road, right? Next time that somebody comes to spur you, consider it a blessing. Right? Consider it a blessing. That the Holy Spirit is working through a brother or sister to come alongside and to give you the encouragement and the stirring up you need to go and act. To love somebody, to serve somebody, to do a good work. Right? It's a blessing. God's not willing to leave you there. He wants you moving. The body needs you moving. The world needs us moving, right? To advance God's kingdom and to seek and save and to go out and to do that kind of work. So let's think of ways. And what are we supposed to think about? Ways to promote, ways to stir up. And these are all different verbiages from different translations. And I'm going to kind of give you the different pictures of each of those, because I think they're needed. They're necessary, right? 10:24. Let us think of ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good deeds. Right, that word motivate is a strong word which literally means to sharpen, right? And figuratively speaks of sharpening one's mind or to stimulate one to action. And you're like, well, okay, I get that. What does that look like practically, right? You flip with me. Keep your finger here. Go back to the book of Acts. Anybody remember when Paul and Barnabas had a little bit of a falling out? Right, there was a little bit of a disagreement going on between them about John Mark, right? Paul didn't really care for him a whole lot. Paul was like, hey, you know, I don't know, this ain't working, right? And so in Acts chapter 15, starting in verse 36, right? Paul and Barnabas separate. They've been doing ministry together. They've been on mission. All of a sudden, there's this parting of ways. And after some days, Paul said to Barnabas, let us return and visit the brothers in every city where we proclaim the word of the Lord and see how they are. Now Barnabas wanted to take with them John called Mark. But Paul thought best not to take with them one who had withdrawn from them in Pamphylia and had not gone with them to the work. And there arose a sharp disagreement so that they separated from each other. Barnabas took Mark with him and sailed away to Cyprus, but Paul chose Silas and departed, having been commended by the brothers to the grace of the Lord, and he went through Syria and Cilicia, strengthening the churches. Like, well, I don't see anything in there about, like, this command to, you know, promote or anything else, right? But there's the thing there, right? Verse 39. And there arose a sharp disagreement. That's the same word that's used in Hebrews 10:24 about how we're to promote or how we're to encourage or how we're to spur on. Same word. Moves you to action. Paul was moved to action over this disagreement that was taking place between him and Barnabas over John Mark, right? There's a disagreement. It drove them to respond. We're supposed to drive one another to respond, to act in certain ways that promote love and good deeds. First word is promote. If you have the Holman Christian Standard Bible, the CSB, right, it uses that word. Let us be concerned about one another in order to promote love and good deeds. What do you do when you promote something? Right? Throw a spotlight on it, right? Put it up on the big screen. We're promoting something. We want people to take notice of that, correct? We want them to catch it. If we're promoting a political candidate, what do we want them to do? Come on. We want them to vote for that candidate, right? We're promoting that candidate. If we're promoting a movie, what do we want them to do? Go see the movie. Or not go see the movie if you're promoting it negatively, right? Don't go to that movie. Right? And so that first idea of stirring up or promoting, if you have the end of the Christian Standard Bible, right, you're putting a spotlight on love and good deeds. You're considering how you can get your brothers and sisters to focus on that and to pursue it. Promote it. Right? Put it in lights. That's what we're supposed to be living like as Christian brothers and sisters, right? We're supposed to be loving and we're supposed to be serving. That's who Jesus is. He came and he loved and he served and he gave his life. Put it in lights. Because that's what we're supposed to be, that's how we're supposed to be living. It's the same way and walking down that path. And so you're shining a light and bringing attention to something that you believe they need to do. And thus you're helping them to maybe see it. Maybe they've become blinded, it's become clouded, it's become blurred because of what's gone on in their life. And we're like, clear all that away. Let me show you the spotlight of what's really important. And all of a sudden, they start to see it, and they move. That's the ultimate purpose down that path. The one that I specifically like is the usage of the word to stir up. Literally, God is calling us to provoke and incite one another. There's two pictures for this one that I'll share with you. The first one is that of a hornet's nest. Anybody ever stir up a hornet's nest? Some of us are chuckling because we know we have, right? And I was, you know, as I think about that analogy, right, of stirring up a hornet's nest, I'm brought back to when I was, I don't know, I was 10, 11 years old, I think, and our neighbor had a garage across the street, and there's this big old hornet's nest on the front of it. Well, so there's the road in between, and there's a little bit of a landing on my mom and dad's property. There was a little bit of a river trench thing that would flow in the springtime, but it was dry. And so me and my buddy are out there, and there's an apple tree. So we went and grabbed all these little hard green apples. And we're like, let's see if we can hit it. And we're chucking apples and, you know, missing and falling short and whatever else. And I was like, well, you know, I can't, you know, I'm not throwing it that far. It's all kind of coming short or coming soft. And so I'm just going to move up a little bit closer, and I'm going to chuck an apple again. So I get up a little bit closer. I biff the apple. I watch it hit, sink into the nest, and I'm like, oh, no. And it's like, what do you do then? Right, so I'm like instantly spin around, start running as fast as I can back to my mom and dad's house. But I get in, we slam the door behind us, and there's like these hornets that hit the window. Not even joking, I'm like, another 5 yards, I was done. Right? But that's what happens, right? By throwing that apple into their nest, it instantly stirred them to action. There was no question. Are we willing to provoke each other that way? Are we willing to incite one another to that kind of activity, to loving good deeds, by coming alongside, poking, encouraging, saying the right words, doing the right things, whatever it takes to go, you need to move. And I'm willing to be that apple into the hornet's nest to get you to move. Because I know it's for your good. It's for the good of God's church. It's the good of the community, whatever it is. But I'm going to incite you. I'm going to stir that up in you. We're literally called to do that, church. Right, to stir, and that's not always comfortable, but it's good. And now there may be a little softer picture for you, right? If maybe you don't like the whole stirring up of a hornet's nest, right? That's a little bit, you know, a little bit too far out. That's a little too dangerous, whatever it might be. Right? Many of us, if you've owned a home, if you've done any kind of service projects, any kind of painting, what happens to paint cans after they sit for a while? They separate, right? They think the paint separates into different portions, right? All the stuff doesn't mix. You would hope that, you know, just put it all in. It should always stay the one color. It doesn't. It separates over the course of time if you're not careful. So you go back and you grab that old paint can from the back room. You pop the lid and there's this clear liquid on top. And you're like, well, that's not going to paint anything. Right? And so you grab your stick, right? You stick the stick in the can and you start to stir it. And before long, what happens? Paint becomes usable, right? It's ready to be applied to the walls. Right? And so this idea of stirring up, if you will, right, has the same thing. It's taking the contents that are in that can and mixing them back together again so that they become functional and able to be applied to the walls. The same thing in our spiritual walk. But I believe every one of us here has the necessary ingredients to do the work that God's called us to do. Would you agree? Right? Because of what Christ has done, because the Holy Spirit indwells us as believers in Christ, we have everything we need. Right? We've been given His love. We've been given examples. We've been given the power to serve. We've been given all the gifts to serve. We have all of that stuff. The problem is that sometimes we get like that old paint can that's just been sitting on the shelf. And it's kind of separated out. And we need a brother or sister to come along and stir those ingredients back together to get us to go out and actually become applicable to people's lives. Right, to actually be able to demonstrate and to serve and to love one another. Right, the love is already there. I'm not adding anything to any of you. I don't believe. I don't. It's there. Right, because you're brothers and sisters. Because I know you, right? I know that that's there. I just need to find out some way to get that active in you again. And sometimes I need you to find ways to make that active in me again when I've allowed it to be separated out. So we're supposed to stir one another up, right? Because sometimes we sit on the shelf and those good works settle to the bottom because we've been at this for many years and like, you know what? I've done my time. Right? I've been at this 30 years. I can just sit now. I've done my part. Right? If you're still here and you've been in the church 30 years and you've been serving, you've still got a part. Your paint can's not empty, right? The tank is still there, right? God still intends to use you, right? Allow people to stir you to do it, right? To motivate you to action, to the advancement of His kingdom. Another version, depending on what you have, right? It's the New American Standard. It uses the word stimulate. Right? I think stimulate adds a good picture to this as well. For some of us who maybe struggle with some of those ones, maybe we need to stimulate one another to love and good deeds. Anybody here have a TENS machine? A TENS device. Right? Bob Hawking said of a TENS device, right? So maybe some of you others have it too, right? It's this little device. They put a little pads on your back or on your leg or whatever, right? Sends little electrical impulses through, right? To bring relief, to bring health, to bring growth into the muscles, or to bring relief to the nerves, right? It's little electrical impulses that connect through the pads. It's a TENS device, right? And they're used to promote healing and health and whatnot, right? But the whole point is it brings stimulation to the muscles and the nerves. Who needs to be stimulated to love and good deeds? Right? Maybe it's you. You need somebody to stimulate you, to get it rolling again. Right? I could look at it from a perspective of you know, maybe a TENS device isn't the right thing, just as I'm thinking through here right now. Right? Maybe we need to think about it as an AED machine. What do AED machines do? They shock and stimulate the heart to act again, do they not? They shock the heart to get it back into rhythm again, right? That's what AEDs do. Maybe that's part of our job. Stimulate one another to love and good works when we become complacent. Right? Who is that that you've been called to do that with? That's really uncomfortable. And that's kind of the sense again. I don't know if I want to stimulate people. We need it, church. We do. We need to stimulate one another to get active and to be moving in our faith on a consistent basis. The writer of Hebrews wouldn't have put it in there if it wasn't necessary. And then the last one is the spur. For many of you have probably ridden a horse. I have never ridden a horse. Right? Not once. Not glad. I'm kind of glad I didn't. I've taken care of horses over the course of my lifetime. I've never ridden one. I don't really have a desire to ride one. But I've seen enough country western movies to know that real cowboys wear spurs, right? That's just the truth, right? They wear spurs, and what was the purpose of the spur? Get them to move, right? Horse doesn't want to go. Little poke with the spurs, off goes the horse. Who's ready to be spurred? I don't think the horse necessarily enjoys the spur, right? but he needs it sometimes. We need to spur one another on. And I believe sometimes it's because we're sitting still. Like I said a moment ago, we're laid out on the couch. We're good. I'm happy with where I'm at. I don't need to do anything. Right? We need somebody to come along and take that spur, and those spurs aren't always very pretty, right? And give that spur and give us a little jolt. Wake up. Move. Ready to spur. Right? No matter how you look at it, right? Motivating one another is about getting one another to go and do love, good works, good deeds, to be active in our faith. I don't care which one of those maybe gives you the right picture. Right? Stirred up, stimulated, promoted, spurred on. I don't care which one it is. And if there's a different one that I didn't touch, that's fine too. Right? But do it. Right? Because it's important that we do. And the other point is, and I already made a statement of it, is that it involves all of us. Right? Verse 24 says, with let us. Right? We do not need to be concerned that we are to be the motivator for everybody. It's a body function. Can't be done in isolation. Right? It needs the body, but it's a body function. Right? So you're not the only source of godly inspiration for your spouse, for your children, for your brothers and sisters. Right? It's all of us coming together. And my guess is, if you've been in the church any duration of time, if you've been serious about your walk with the Lord, you've experienced this. And I wrote it in my notes here, right? Confirmation is a powerful tool that God uses. Right? And what I mean by that is you've been sitting here, you've been feeling the Lord like, you know, I need to go do something. And maybe if you're married, your spouse is like, hey, you know, the Lord showed me you need to go do X. And like, just my wife. Whatever. You know, I can blow her off. And all of a sudden you go to work or you come to church and a brother comes up to you and goes, hey, I was really thinking about you this week. And then, by the way, you know what? The Lord put this on my heart about you. Are you supposed to go do this? All of a sudden you go, my wife told me. My buddy told me. Maybe God's trying to tell me something. No? But confirmation is a beautiful thing in the body of Christ. Right? So the Lord is concerned about that realm. And so if you're getting it from multiple angles, which we should be, it's time to move. It's a body function. It motivates us to move forward, and it takes the body to do that at times. Because disconnected believers telling you something that's similar, it has a motivating factor to get you to go. And then to close this whole thing out, right, our motivation is to stir one another up into action. I don't need to spend a whole lot of time down that path because we spent the last 2 weeks talking about it. Right? The first one is supposed to stir us up to love, agape love, right? Unrestricted, unrestrained, right? Unqualified, right? No limits, barred kind of love. Well, but I love them. Yeah, but you have these restraints on it. You're not willing to go acts. God's asking you to go acts, but you're only willing to go so far. Well, yeah, but you know, that's what they did this and they did this, and if they would respond this way, that's fine. I'd continue to love them, but because they won't, I'm not going to. Need a brother or sister to go, no, that's not the way love works. Jesus didn't stop at some point and go, if you did X, then he'll continue to love you. He doesn't do that. Right? And so we need those brothers or sisters to come along and to remind us and to spur us on to going, get over that and go love them unconditionally. Right? Pour yourself out on their behalf. Right? Take your roll of pennies, break it open, and let it go. Right? That's the kind of love we've been called to. Easy? No, not all the time. Not in all situations. That's why we need the body to give us that encouragement, that spurring to move. Right? Acts of selfless love, right? It's not always easy, but it is easier when we're encouraged to do it. Right? Some of that is why we meet for men's breakfast on Saturday mornings. There's some of that kind of encouragement that goes on, that goes, I know you might be struggling with acts, and all of a sudden brothers will come in, they'll share different things, like different life experiences, different wisdom, right? And they share that on, and all of a sudden you can leave that place encouraged and going, I got it, I'm going to go act, I'm going to go try it. And that's happened over the course of years in the men's group. Right? So that's just been a blessing down that road, is to see the body of Christ work that way. We don't hear a brother sit there and go, I'm struggling with X, and then go, it's okay, you don't need to do it. And I get it. It's hard. It's difficult. Yeah, I wouldn't do that either. That's not what happens around that table on Saturday morning. Right? They, more often than not, it's like, you know what? Okay, you got that. Then go. What does it take to go? Why are you afraid to go? Whatever. And we start asking those types of questions. And then the beauty of it is in the next men's breakfast, that brother comes back and they share, well, you know, I took the chance. It didn't work very well. Or, you know, I didn't go all the way, but I got part way. And so I've made steps. Right? That's what we're supposed to do, right? That's the spurring part of it. Needing to go down that path to love. And then the second one, of course, is motivating one another to good works. Right? Love and good works overlap. They just do. Right? Because love looks like something, right? One's got it. Service to your neighbor. Love looks like something. Always does. It doesn't sound like words coming off of my lips. It looks like something, church. It looks like serving our neighbors. It looks like good works. It looks like good deeds. It looks like serving other people inside and outside the church. Right? Good works. You say, well, what are some of those? Right? It's helping someone move, leading a Bible study, buying groceries, sitting and visiting, right? Holding somebody's hand as they're going through something, just listening to them. But those are all small things of good works that we can do. A lot of them don't take whole lot of resources on our behalf other than time. But are we willing to do those good works? Well, I'm just really, really busy. Okay. That's a good answer. I'm busy too, so we just won't do it. Is that what we're supposed to do? I don't think so. Right? But unfortunately, and we talked about this at our men's breakfast, right? Too often that's exactly what we do. Because it's a whole lot easier that way, because if I end up calling you out, if I spur you, right, and you get uncomfortable, but you go do it, right, the next time I'm in a spot, chances are you're going to come and spur me too. So it's just easier to go, you know what, I get it, you're really busy, you know, God will have to find somebody else. Then you don't hold me accountable to it either. And then we all just tell each other we're good. Nobody gets spurred. We all just become complacent. We all kick back on the couch and we watch Christianity happen, but we don't participate. Right? Christianity is an action sport, if you will. Right? It takes our involvement. It's not something we get to sit and watch happen. God didn't save a single one of us in this room so that we could sit down and watch life go by. He saved us so that we can be out in the harvest field, that we can be involved in advancing his kingdom, which means we have to get participatory. Not just sitting down. Loving good works. Moving through life. And those good works not only bless others, but they say a lot about your character. Right? First Peter chapter 2, last verse for this morning. 1 Peter chapter 2. Verse 11, right? Beloved, I urge you as sojourners and exiles, right? This isn't our home. Right? We live here physically, but this isn't our home. Right? Heaven is our home. Right? We're from a different kingdom. We're ambassadors. We're sojourners. We're exiles. We're all these things, right? This isn't home. Right? He goes, to abstain from the passions of the flesh which wage war against your soul. Keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable, so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation. That our good deeds speak to the truth of when the evildoers, right, when the world watches and they want to point out that you're evil and they see your good deeds and it gives testimony, it goes, no, 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 not true. Right? Evil people don't do those types of things. They don't love like that. They don't serve like that. They don't sacrifice like that. Right? There's limits to all of their things. They don't seem to have limits. Why? Right? And they glorify God, right? You can go back to Matthew and Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount. He says the same thing in Matthew 5, what, 16-ish, right? Where the light is of the world, right? Don't put your light under a bushel, right? Let them see your good deeds because they'll praise your Father who's in heaven. There's why we're supposed to spur one another to good deeds. Because when people see our good deeds, they praise and glorify God. They don't praise and glorify you and me. They praise him. And that's where we want it to go, correct? It doesn't matter to me, truthfully, and I've had negative people say things to me about it, right? I don't necessarily care if this church grows to 5,000 people. It doesn't really matter to me. What matters to me is that God's kingdom grows by 5,000 people. Would it be really cool to have it happen here? Sure, great, wonderful, great, you know, whatever. But that's not really the goal. The goal is that the people are added to his kingdom and that he receives the praise, honor, and glory for it, not Hope Fellowship. Like, that's the purpose. Like, that's our heart, is to push everybody back. And so when people speak badly about you, they see your good works, and all of a sudden they say, those don't line up. And they glorify your Father. Now, let's spur one another. So in conclusion, each one of us here this morning, right, if you put your faith and trust in Christ, if you're part of the body of Christ, if you're in the family, if you're a son or a daughter, if you're a co-heir with Christ, whatever verbiage, whatever analogy you want to use, right, if you're part of the body of Christ, right, you've been called to participate in this one another in activity. All the spurring is not to come from me. It's not to come from the elders only. It's not supposed to come just from your Bible study leaders, right? It's to come from every one of us. It's called the spur. Maybe we need to lead by example, yes, right? That's fine. If that can be part of that encouragement, right? Part of that spurring is like, I'm willing to go with you. I'm willing to take the lead, whatever. But we all need to be participating in it. And that requires us that we would be thinking about each other through the week. Start in your family. Start with your spouse. Right? How can I spur them on to greater love and good deeds? Now, you should know them pretty well. Maybe it shouldn't take a whole lot of thinking power, but right? But spur one another. Right? I don't want to say a competition, but you know what? Be with one another in your family, and how do I spur my husband or my wife or my kids or my parents to love and good deeds? How do we increase that in amongst our immediate family? Or amongst our Bible study group? Right? Let's be intentional about going, okay, there's been a ladies' Bible study going on. I don't know if it's still going on, but if it is, right, maybe this Thursday you sit down and go, okay, when I go this Thursday, I want to think about how I can spur a sister on. Right, I've seen this. They've been talking about this thing that they need to go do, that they feel God's moving them to. God, how can I spur them? How can I stir them up to finally take a step of action, to step into it and going, I'm going to fulfill that. It requires us to think about each other and consider and study one another. And then, but the amazing thing is don't just sit there and study. Eventually, actually do it. Take the chance. Put out your heel. Give them a little kick. See what happens. For those of us who are getting a kick, please do not be offended. Right? Maybe we didn't do it quite perfectly. Maybe we kicked a little too hard. Right? We're practicing. We're growing. We're learning. Right? What this looks like to spur. And so when somebody finally does give you the kick, receive it. Don't instantly get up front. Don't instantly rear up like some maybe a horse does at times because, you know, they rear up and like, well, that wasn't good, so I'm going to get rid of the rider. Don't do that. Right, brothers or sisters are trying to love you truly. They're trying to serve you, done from a right heart. Right, and that this would continue to increase throughout the body of Christ. Because we're all likely to go through a season when we need it. Right, we're all going to need seasons when we become complacent and we need a little bit of a boost to say, get out there and keep going. Right, if you're in that good spot, do it now, because eventually that time is going to reverse. Let's go ahead and close out in prayer. Father God, I thank you for the truth, for the reality of this one another, that we're supposed to stir one another up, that we're supposed to spur one another on, that we're supposed to promote, we're supposed to stimulate, whatever analogy we want to use. But God, there is, if we're honest with ourselves, if we'll sit before you and allow you to reveal our hearts, there's times when we become complacent in our faith. There's times when you've asked us, maybe we're not even really super complacent, but there's something you've asked us to do that we just keep putting on the back burner. No, we're not doing that. No, we're not doing that. We're making up excuses left and right as to why we can't. Holy Spirit, it's in those moments that we need brothers or sisters to come along, guided by you, to stimulate us to move, to get us to finally take that step of action to love and good deeds towards somebody or some situation. Father, I pray that you would help us to be considerate in this task. That we wouldn't do it frivolously, we wouldn't do it unprepared, that we would truly take, as the writer of Hebrews said, the time to consider our brothers and sisters, that it may be done in love, that it may be done in humility, to come alongside with the true heart of not inflicting pain, but to promote growth, in their lives and in their walk with you. Lord, it's so crucial that we take that preparatory time, that we take the time to think it through, to see what you're truly asking of us. But then give us the boldness, once we've sat and done that time, done that examination, done that study, give us the boldness and the courage to actually step into it and to give the nudge, to give the spur, to give the stir. Lord, if it means that we have to throw the apple under the hornet's nest, then that's what needs to be done. Maybe that's what it takes. God, make us available and willing to be that apple. If it means stirring a brother or sister to action, that brings you praise, honor, and glory. Lead us in this path as a community of believers. It's in your name, Jesus, that we pray.